People have bombarded me with messages about a video on remelting 3D prints installed. So here we go. I printed a ton of different parts in PLA, PLA+, PETG and ABS, remelted them in different grain sizes of salt, and tested them for their strength. Don't tune away. This technique might be the most significant post-processing technique for 3D printing there ever was. Let's find out more. Guten Tag, everybody. I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. Part of this video is sponsored by Audible. Start listening with a 30-day Audible trial. Get one audiobook and full access to the Plus catalog absolutely free. Visit audible.com/cnckitchen or text cnckitchen to 500-500. Remelting 3D prints in salt seems to be the new hype, and I see why. In comparison to my plaster annealing method, you simply embed your 3D prints in salt, put everything in the oven to remelt the plastic, and end up with injection molded strength 3D prints. Or do you? After watching my video on plaster annealing, a viewer named FreeSpirit1 posted a video on his salt remelting method that he has been working on in the past. Well, and it became kind of viral. In his video, he showed how the process basically works, though I started further investigating it, looking at salt grain sizes, treatment temperatures, dimensional accuracy, and most importantly, strength. I'll also discuss the pros and cons of using table salt and what alternatives there could be. Have you already tried this method on your own? Then let us know how it works down in the comments. What applications do you see, and is it worth the effort? Since I wanted to know how and if the process works with a broader range of materials, I printed samples in regular DasFilament PLA and PETG, as well as ESUN ABS and their highly requested PLA+. My primary test specimen was a square block with threads on the top and a fitting nut. This gave me the possibility to check easily measurable dimensions and take a look at the fine details of the threads and if they're still working after the process. Of course, if you use this remelting process, you need to print your part with 100% infill. If not, you'll end up with big holes in your part, and that doesn't only affect the look, but also makes the mechanical properties very unpredictable. First, let's take a look at the main component of this process, and this is the salt. Regular table salt is way too coarse and is not suitable in many ways, as I'll show you. What you want is powder salt. Unfortunately, this isn't something that you can buy in regular stores, at least not here in Germany. Powder salt, flour salt, or popcorn salt is available on Amazon, though at ridiculous prices, costing more than 10 bucks per kilo, and still might be too coarse to reproduce fine details. The thing is that your surface finish and also dimensional accuracy is directly dependent on the grain size that you use. The finer, the better. I bought a large bucket of salt and used my Thermomix, which is basically an expensive blender, to make my powder salt. Unfortunately, I quickly noticed that the salt starts to smear and clump up during the process, so I was only able to process batches of 300 to 400 grams at a time. If you also want to do this at home, pay attention, because I've already read a couple of times on Reddit and Facebook that people destroyed their coffee grinder while trying to pulverize salt. Go in small batches and leave your machine time to cool down. For my first tests, I let the blender run for 15 seconds at full speed, though after the first remelting run noticed that this was still too coarse, and later let it run for 30 seconds. That's what I used for most of my tests, though in hindsight I should probably even go longer to remove the last bigger grains and end up with a really fine, flour-like consistency. After my first run, I also noticed that I need to have a vacuum close by, because you generate a nasty salt dust that potentially starts rusting everything close by. Also wear gloves, because the salt dries out your hands and you don't want to look like an Egyptian mummy. The next important thing is, packing your parts in salt, because this will determine if the material can flow away in voids that you created, or if your prints nicely stay in shape and you're able to reproduce all of the details. I use stainless steel GN containers that are relatively high. For the 1.5 liters, I used around 2.2 kilograms of salt. I broke up bigger clumps using a sieve to ensure that the salt is nice and fine. First, I added a good layer on the bottom of the container and then added the parts while making sure that they are properly spaced to not melt together. Then I added more salt and tapped the container regularly so that the fine powder was able to flow into all cracks and details. I topped everything up with plenty more salt and then started compacting everything by just pressing everything together with a second container. This is also why the powder salt is essential. Regular table salt or sand can't be compacted so that it holds its shape. Powder salt, with its fine and sharp crystals, though, forms quite a solid mass if compacted and compressed. Compacting will not only make sure that there are no voids left, it will also ensure that the parts can't deform anymore and therefore reduce warping to a minimum. I only compress the salt right at the end. Though, looking at the flashing that I got on some of the parts and some deformation, it might have been better to compact several times while adding more and more salt, as shown in Free Spirit 1's video. The height of the container is also important in my opinion, because that will give you additional rigidity above the part and will not require weighting the top surface during the heat treatment step. So if you only have a smaller pan, add something flat and heavy to weigh the top surface down. Oh. And by the way, if you find this and my other investigations helpful, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell. Let's next get to the heat treatment step. Suggested temperatures were 230 degrees Celsius for PLA and even more for PETG and ABS for at least 45 minutes. That seemed a bit weird to me, because that's way above the melting point of these materials and even higher then you'd even print them. The thing is that long exposure to high heat will damage the polymer by hydrolysis, oxidation, additive evaporation, and some other reasons more. So I thought I'd start at lower temperatures, but added a barbecue thermometer to see what temperature we really have in the core of our salt block. Salt is not a great conductor of heat, so it will take a considerable amount of time until you get to a kind of even temperature distribution. If you go with higher temperatures, the core will also heat up faster, but in the end, you'll have an overcooked outside and maybe even still too low temperatures in the core. My lab oven doesn't have forced air convection, and in here, at a set temperature of 210 degrees Celsius, it took me more than 4 hours to even get close to that on the inside. My forced convection kitchen oven speeds this process up a little, but still takes a good 2 hours to get close to the target temperature. So if you want to take this method seriously, get a barbecue thermometer and put it into the salt to time the point at which you can turn off the oven. I usually did that when I was 10 degrees below the set oven temperature, because that was a reasonable temperature gradient I was comfortable with. For my part, I let the prints cool down in the salt overnight, roughly cleaned them from the powder remains, and then tossed them into water to dissolve the rest of the grains on the surface. In the end, I tried 180 degrees Celsius, 190, 210, and at most 230 degrees Celsius for the ABS part. 180 degrees Celsius up to 210 degrees Celsius was totally sufficient for PLA and also PETG. All parts showed noticeable signs of remelting with this very matte surface finish. The 3D benches that were only printed at 20% infill also illustrated why fully dense parts are necessary for this process. The 100% infill benchy came out nice though, with great surface details. For ABS, 180 degrees Celsius was just not enough. We were able to see that the part got soft, but not all the way, so that it melted. 190 degrees Celsius looked already better. If we go way higher, in my case to 230 degrees Celsius, the smell does not only get bad, but we can also spot severe discoloration and browning of the parts that also shows up in the salt. The tensile test parts will later tell us if this affected only the outer surface or if we ruined the whole part. When comparing the different grain sizes that I tried, we can also see that the finer the salt is, the better the surface gets. So with my salt, I wasn't able to reach the clarity of what Free Spirit One showed in his video. Surface finish was very similar for all of the three materials, and this cooling nozzle also illustrates that we're able to treat small and thin-walled parts. I checked the amount of warping and deformation first by simply screwing the nut on the thread. For PLA and PETG, this only worked if I applied a significant amount of force. The overall dimensions didn't change hugely, but still a little, and I rather think that the problem with screwing the parts together comes from the porous surface, which makes both inner and outer threads slightly bigger. ABS worked better in that regard, and I still was able to screw the parts together, and overall dimensions didn't change a lot. My deformation analysis part also only showed dimensional changes below 1%, which is a bit, but still way less than if you would anneal without a medium that holds the parts in shape. But now let's finally take a look at the most exciting part. How did the strength of our 3D printed parts change? Does this method fuse everything together and heal the layer adhesion deficiency that we usually have? With plaster annealing, I also noticed that probably the water in the plaster affected especially the PLA and made it very brittle. Does this method, where no water is involved, affect the polymer less? For this investigation, I printed a bunch of my old layer adhesion samples that have a bigger cross-section than my mini test samples. This way, surface porosity influences the results less. These are for judging layer adhesion. Raw material performance as a reference value was judged by simple dog bone samples. Half of the samples got remelted and salt, the other half was left as printed as the untreated reference. All the test samples were remelted at 200 degrees Celsius set in the oven, and I turned it off when it reached 190 degrees in the core of the salt block. The samples did look good with no major deformation, and only some showed a bit of flashing that I had to trim away. Unfortunately, some showed bigger porosity that might impact the later results. Regular untreated PLA has a tensile strength of the lying specimens of 61 megapascals. The untreated layer adhesion samples were only half as strong with 31 megapascals. PLA Plus has a slightly lower ultimate tensile strength of 54 megapascals, but yielded and didn't fail. The reference layer adhesion was 30 megapascals. The PETG samples were similarly strong with 55 megapascals printed lying and an impressive 40 megapascals in the vertical orientation. ABS was the weakest with 40 megapascals of tensile strength in its optimal position and only 14 megapascals of layer adhesion, which is often a problem for this material, especially if it's not printed in a heated chamber. Let's now take a look at PLA, remelted in salt. The samples broke quite violently and were able to reach almost the strength of the ideally printed parts, which is more than impressive. If we take a look at the fracture surface, the remelted sample is perfectly homogenic with only the porous seam around. The untreated sample clearly shows the print lines. So the porosity that we've seen on the part seems to be mostly only the first layer of salt that mixed with the molten plastic and out of which we have then dissolved the salt crystals using the water. This is good because that means with a smaller grain size we should be able to reduce the porosity and also we didn't produce plastic foam. Next I tested PLA Plus. The material strength improved in a very similar way. And we almost reach ideal part strength. Unfortunately, I think some ductility is lost because the material snaps without any significant necking, like we have seen it on the dog bone sample. Still, very impressive results with a really low scatter. Then it was time for PETG. I've tested more samples and temperatures than I can fit in this video, but here I'll go into details on two where we can see something interesting. If you, by the way, want to get your hands on the complete results, they are accessible if you're a patron or a YouTube member. During printing the samples, I ran out of red PETG, so I switched to a roll of gray one, also from DasFilament, that was already open for significantly longer. Both samples failed at around the same stress level, though the gray one simply snapped whereas the red one yielded and necked quite significantly. This might be due to the gray filament already absorbing more moisture and becoming brittle, though this would require deeper investigations for a definitive answer. The strength itself was remarkable, basically reaching the one of the ideally printed part, which clearly says that salt remelting PETG fuses the layers perfectly together, creating a homologous part with isotropic properties. Both PLA and PLA Plus had a perfectly even fracture surface. PETG though shows a significant amount of fine pores where it failed. I don't know if they result from moisture or if they are the leftovers from the printing process that did not rise to the highest section during remelting. Finally, let's take a look at ABS. Here, I was able to increase the layer adhesion by 150%, also reaching 90% of the strength of the dog bone samples. Impressive. The fracture surface doesn't look as even as the one of PLA, but still no layer lines or porosity are visible. Just for completeness, the brown samples treated at 230 degrees Celsius showed equal strength results, so probably only the most outer region is affected at those higher temperatures. Those results again show the significance of this method to get 3D prints just as strong as injection molded parts. Of course, it's a lot of post-processing effort, but if you only need 1 or even 10, it's still way cheaper and efficient than investing in an injection mold that costs more than your car. I think we're still at the beginning of researching this method. I, for example, see the need to also take a look at impact strength, different oven temperatures, other printing materials like nylons or carbon fiber reinforced composites, how to design parts for this method, and how to get them as dense as possible in the first place, and so much more. Is salt really the best material for this, or can we use green sand, talcum, or fine sand? But let me know what your verdict is, what applications you see, and if you want to try this out on your own, please leave your thoughts in the comments. Before we finish, let me quickly recommend an audiobook that's especially interesting for makers and to which I recently listened to using today's video sponsor Audible. Audible has an unmatched selection of audiobooks and something for everyone, regardless of whether you need entertainment while working at home or if your aim is to educate yourself and learn something new. I recently listened to Every Tool's a Hammer by Adam Savage, who should hopefully be familiar to all of you. The audiobook is read by himself, which is great in the first place. He talks about his career as a Mythbuster and, more importantly, his life as a maker. A great listen for everyone who is even only the slightest interested in making, tinkering, or in Adam Savage as a persona. Listen to this or any other audiobook for free by starting a 30-day Audible trial. Get one audiobook and full access to the Plus catalog absolutely free. Visit audible.com/cnckitchen or text cnckitchen to 500-500. No risk involved, and you can even keep all of your audiobooks forever if you at some point decide to cancel the service. Thank you, Audible, for sponsoring part of this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're all doing well. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you're subscribed for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, or use the affiliate links in the description. Go check out my other videos if you currently have more time than usual and want to educate yourself. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.